Good day to all. Today's discussion will continue on the transport system in vascular plants. This time, we will talk about transport involving phloem. Transport involving phloem is called translocation. And there are altogether four hypotheses that try to explain the translocation process, namely mass flow, electroosmosis, cytoplasmic streaming, and peristaltic waves. But first, let's do an overview about translocation by phloem. Here there are two diagrams showing us a comparison between transportation in xylem vessel and translocation in the phloem sieve tube. The first difference is that transportation of water and minerals is a passive process. We've learned earlier, for water molecules and minerals to move up the stem of a plant, it depends on capillary action involving the cohesion tension theory and mass flow. However, for the translocation, ATP is necessary. So it is an active process. Transportation transports water as well as minerals that are dissolved in the water, whereas in translocation, the transport involves mainly sucrose that is dissolved in water. The third difference is that in transportation using xylem, it is in one direction, that is from the root to the leaf, whereas for translocation in the phloem, it is two-way or bidirectional, whereby the sucrose can be transported from the leaf down to the root or from the root up to the leaf. So, in the four hypotheses that we are going to learn about, the scientists will try to explain how active transport is involved and how two-way flow occurs. So let's start. Let's learn about the first hypothesis, that is the electroosmosis hypothesis. This diagram shows us the sieve tube, and the pink color here is the companion cell, where we can see, since the companion cell is an active living cell, its cytoplasm has high amounts of potassium ion. In the sieve tube here, I show you some sucrose molecules that need to be translocated. So let's see how the electroosmosis hypothesis explains the translocation of sucrose. Firstly, the companion cell will start to actively pump potassium ions into the sieve tube. Now, the accumulation of the potassium ions in the sieve tube cause the lower part of the sieve tube to become positively charged. The upper part does not have potassium ions, so the upper part we can consider as negatively charged. So now you see there is an electrochemical gradient. Due to the electrochemical gradient along the sieve tube, the potassium ion will begin to move from the positive end of the sieve tube to the negative end of the sieve tube. So now, the upper part of the sieve tube is positively charged. This will cause sucrose, which is attracted to the positive charge, to also move together with the potassium ion. Now, what has happened is the potassium ion and sucrose begin to accumulate at the upper part of the sieve tube, causing a low water potential to develop. At the lower part of the sieve tube, The absence of the potassium ions and the sucrose cause the lower part to have a high water potential. So now you see a water potential gradient has developed. And because of that, what happens next is that the water molecules will begin to diffuse down the water potential gradient via osmosis. So that is why the hypothesis was given the name electroosmosis. Electro due to the potassium ions causing an electrochemical gradient, and osmosis due to the movement of water down the water potential gradient. Biologists are able to accept the electroosmosis hypothesis because this hypothesis is able to explain the function of the companion cell, that is to generate ATP to carry out translocation. And the hypothesis also supports the idea that translocation is an active process. However, the hypothesis is not widely accepted because of a few issues. The issue is that the hypothesis is unable to explain bidirectional flow. Now, biologists already know that the phloem does translocation in two directions, downwards as well as upwards. But we can see, based on the electroosmosis hypothesis, it can only explain movement in one direction. Secondly, the hypothesis is unable to explain how the sucrose from one sieve tube moves into the next sieve tube via the sieve plates. So, let's look at the second hypothesis, which is the cytoplasmic streaming hypothesis. In this microscope image, we can see the chloroplast moving along with the cytoplasm. So there is visual evidence that cytoplasm moves within a cell. So the cytoplasmic streaming hypothesis uses this concept. Sieve tube will have cytoplasm at the periphery of the cell wall. And in that cytoplasm, there will be molecules such as water and sucrose. These molecules will have their own intrinsic kinetic energy. And using that kinetic energy, these molecules are able to circulate within the cytoplasm. As the molecules circulate within the sieve tube element, they tend to slow down once they arrive at the sieve plate. Then what happens is these molecules will be forced out through the sieve pores. This is an active process involving use of ATP, and it is the companion cell that will generate the ATP for cytoplasmic streaming to happen. Now, the reasons why cytoplasmic streaming is accepted as a hypothesis for translocation is, firstly, it is able to explain bidirectional translocation. Okay, where you can see as the molecules circulate, they can either circulate upwards in one area and circulate downwards in the other area of the sieve tube. Secondly, it explains the function of the companion cell, that is to generate ATP. And of course, it helps to support the idea that translocation is an active process. But let's look at the reasons why cytoplasmic streaming is not accepted completely by the biologist. The problem with this hypothesis is that cytoplasmic streaming is a very slow process. it will not be able to keep the plant alive. Secondly, in mature cells, that is in adult cells, we cannot visually see cytoplasmic streaming happening. Finally, translocation is found to occur even in older cells, although in older cells, ATP production is reduced. So, we come next to the third hypothesis that tries to explain translocation. That is the peristaltic wave hypothesis. In the peristaltic wave hypothesis, the sieve tube elements contain fine cytoplasmic filaments. These filaments pass through the sieve pore into the next sieve tube element. So, the filaments make a continuous connection between the sieve tube elements. Then we see these cytoplasmic filaments are able to actually constrict and relax. So, when they do that, they form a peristaltic wave. This peristaltic wave, of course, requires ATP since it is an active process, and that ATP can be supplied by the companion cell. So, let's look at how this characteristic can help in translocation of sucrose. Now, in between the cytoplasmic filaments, there is what we call the phloem sap. And the phloem sap will have water and dissolved sucrose in it. So, when the peristaltic wave occurs, the phloem sap is actually squeezed and pushed from one sieve tube element into the other. You can see the direction of movement can either be upwards or downwards depending on the movement of the peristaltic wave. So, this hypothesis is actually quite a well-accepted hypothesis because it is able to explain bidirectional translocation, the role of the companion cell, and supports the fact that translocation is an active process. However, it is still not completely accepted because of some problems. The issue is that when the phloem becomes old, the companion cells stop producing ATP. However, translocation still occurs in the absence of ATP. Secondly, there are some plants that do not show the presence of the cytoplasmic filaments, and yet translocation continues to occur. And the same problem as cytoplasmic streaming, peristaltic wave is too slow. So, we still do not have a perfect hypothesis to explain translocation. The final hypothesis is the mass flow hypothesis. Mass flow hypothesis is one of the most popular hypotheses that is accepted by biologists, and that is why in our syllabus, it is followed up with the concept of source and sink. So, for that, I will explain in our upcoming video. Until then, goodbye.